sports.com. Check UUSports.com for more information about that. And we'll also be a live radio broadcast on KCNB 104.7 FM.
How's it going?
Keith Scarlett, Real Talk Scarlett. Coach, welcome once again. And we'll go ahead and rewind to Friday. You had Southern Oregon come in, a very talented program, off to the best start in this program history. Showed us athleticism Friday, a 3-0 victory here. Talk a little bit about Friday's game.
They're just the better team. I mean, they were just the better team. I talked with Coach Clement before the game, and he had talked about, you know, how he had, you know, spent the last 3-4 years trying to build up, you know, the program and bring in the right types of students and student athletes, you know, across the board and everything, and that this is the first year that he really felt as if he had the personnel and the depth and so forth to stand toe-to-toe with Concordia, the conference, and have an actual opportunity at getting things done and making a run. And so you know, he said it's been a 4-year build, and so it showed. You know, they were athletic, they were long. He recruits those types of student athletes, and he's been able to find those, and that's a good thing. And you know, and he had how the school had backed him and so forth. So there's actually quite a few similarities to what he was talking about, and you know, I don't know necessarily that's what he was getting at, but you know, there's quite a few similarities to, you know, to their program now, to where it was 4 years ago, to where we are right now. So
now on Saturday, a dramatic homecoming win. Katie Arnell found the back of the net with 58 seconds left in the first overtime. I mean, how did that feel?
Well, I mean, it was. You know, I actually didn't see her take the shot. I didn't see how it developed until I saw film, because the minute was ticking away and I was going back to my notes to figure out, you know, what we were gonna, you know, how we were gonna handle the 2-minute break and how we were gonna deal with the second overtime period, because you know, they seemed to be just kind of slowing up, and you know, we were, of course, you know, getting to the point, same thing, and then all of a sudden I looked up and ball's going towards the back post and it goes in. So, and it felt very good. I mean, it was the feeling that I got, and it's really ironic because it was a conference win. It wasn't any for the whole enchilada, but the feeling I got was very similar to the feeling I got when we won a high school state championship, and we won it, you know, against some really, you know, adverse conditions and everything. One of those feelings to where I just kind of dropped the clipboard and just kind of stood there, you know, put my hands on my knees and kind of just, you know, this relief, this pressure off the shoulders. Because what that win did was put us in a position to where we control our own fate all the way the rest of the way. We have 3 games remaining, 2 this weekend, and then College of Idaho the next week, and we control our own fate. We can get ourselves into the postseason if we take care of, without help, if we take care of business on our own. So you know, we knew a draw would still keep us in the picture, and depending on other results, a draw would allow us the opportunity to still control our own fate potentially, but a W would do so. And so the fact that they, you know, they didn't settle for coming out into overtime with the draw, one of the win, was a positive thing.
Yeah, right now you guys are sitting 6th, and those top 4 teams head to the postseason. But Northwest Christian here you travel with Northwest Christian Friday. The Beacons, you know, kind of near that bottom of the pack, but it's the same thing I talked to Coach Pierce about, especially on the road in this conference. There's no easy team to beat.
Well, no, there's not at all. And now, back with them, you said 6th. We hold the tiebreaker on one of those teams, and we hold the tiebreaker on one of those teams, and then we hold a couple tiebreakers on one or two above us, and we still have to face. And
okay.
So I just, it's listed 6, but they listed by your overall record.
Okay.
And so it kind of goes through like that. But you know, Northwest Christian's a team that they got nothing to lose. You know, they mathematically are out of the picture. They're just trying to, you know, with a new coach this year, trying to, you know, build and go forward. You know, they're going to fight all the way through. Statistically, for the record they have, they're statistically very even keeled, very even across the board. You know, except a team that, you know, has lost games. They've lost to really be one-sided statistically, but they're not the athletic filter. So we'll get an opportunity Thursday night to you know, to get out and knock the ball around on that. But that's going to change the dynamic of the game. And it doesn't make a difference where they stand or whether they're mathematically eliminated or not. The fact of the matter is that we have to win. You know, if we want to keep a postseason hopes alive, we have to get the W. So that's the pivotal game of the season right there. That will set the stage in so many different facets for us, one way or the other, to how we handle that game on Friday.
Now, Corbin, you'll head to Salem on Saturday. They're having a great season, especially at home. How tough are these Warriors?
They are a very dynamic team. You know, Southern Oregon was very athletic, but at the same time, they were predictable. Oregon Tech was athletic in a similar mindset, but they were also very predictable. Corbin is very athletic, but very dynamic. You have an idea what they're going to do, but yet they will change it. They'll problem solve. They'll create some issues in that sense. They're not a big team. They're not a long team. They're definitely not as athletic as Southern Oregon is. They will put pressure on you. And the reason they're so dangerous at home is because of the fact that they get a very good crowd support. They get a lot of student support that comes out for them. And the issue with them is that how they come out of the College of Idaho game on Friday will have a real huge impact on how they come into the game on Saturday. If they're not successful against College of Idaho, their postseason hopes are dwindling, and they're going to have to scrape something out against it. If they're successful against College of Idaho, on the same token, their postseason hopes are alive and well, and they're going to have to take care of us to do it. So it's one of those things to where we're going to, outside of the regular fact that it's Cascade Conference game, outside of all that, Corbin's going to give us everything they have, regardless, just for the simple fact that no matter what the result is, they get no fight against College of Idaho, they're either in bad trouble or they're in great shape. And so we have to be ready to play. But we actually aren't worried about Corbin. We're not thinking about Corbin right now. The game against Northwest Christian is absolutely pivotal and critical. I mean, with, you know, the ups and downs of the season, you know, with some of the results we had early on, you know, if you would have said, you and I'd be talking here on this time and saying that we're actually have the ability to make postseason in our own hands, I probably would have, you know, hit you in the side of the head and said, what are you thinking? You know, it's you know, but we found some things, found some identity, got our feet underneath us, and so I have to go out and take care of business.
Well, Coach, we appreciate you always coming by, and wish you best of luck this Friday and Saturday.
Thank you.
Have a good trip. And we'll go ahead and have Coach Ben Walsh come up next. Mountaineer Soccer will be on the road with their games at Northwest Christian on Friday and Corbin on Saturday. Coach Ben Welch of the cross-country program had an excellent home meet on Saturday for homecoming. There you go. I think we need to put a manual up there with these headsets.
Yeah, we're just handicapped.
Coach, like I said, great meet on Saturday. Talk a little about that turnout.
It was good. I mean, you know, it was a little smaller than it normally is, as I mentioned last week, you know, but they made good use of it. I thought the athletes did a real good job of working on the specifics that we wanted to work on.
Now, I know the men do this real well, but the ladies ran a very well-packed race. Carly Coffey left for a little bit there before dropping off due to some illness, and then Sarah Hanschett won that race. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. The goal was to get that pack of gals that have been trying to get to work together out through the mile at a specific time, and they were spot on. Carly's job was just to get them through the mile there, and then I told them they could kind of do whatever they wanted from there, but they should really try and push, and Sarah cranked. Yeah, because she ran away from people that were running pretty fast. To put it into perspective, you don't really need to know, you know, the significance of the time as much as the differential. They went through the mile in 6 minutes, and then she was running 5:40 mile pace after that. So that's a pretty significant drop in time.
Yes, it is. Now, DJ Flores did what he does, and he led the men again, and then ended up winning that race. Talk about what kind of season DJ is off to right now.
You know, it was 16th at the national meet last year, and he's running significantly ahead of where he ran last year during the season. So now that could, you know, translate into a 24th place finish in nationals this year, depending on how many